Okay. Hello everyone again. It's my pleasure today to introduce our speaker, Dr. Nadia Sukurova. She is a faculty member of Swinburne University of Technology, and she is an expert on optimization and rational approximation. Today, she is going to talk about rational approximation, its roles in different branches of mathematics and applications. Nadia, it's your step now.
Yeah, thank you very much, Min. Hello, everyone, and thank you so much for coming. So yes, indeed, I will talk about rational approximation. So what I really actually like in this talk, I will probably try to connect together optimization and approximation, so two important branches of mathematics. And then I will also spend some time on applications, of course, because that's something that attracts citations, right? Let's say it is about rational approximation, but in this study, we approach approximation from the point of view of optimization. So we formulate the problems as optimization problem, and then we solve them. So that's basically main idea here. And the problems are quite interesting. Okay, so what I will be talking about. So first of all, a little bit about the motivation. So why rational approximation? So definitely we'll show some connection between approximation and optimization. They really fit each other. And then at the end, the applications. So one application is in computational chemistry. And another one, so I'm talking about deep learning, but there are actually several applications in deep learning. So let's see how much we can cover today. Okay, so first of all, before I start talking about rational approximation, probably need to say a few words about Chebyshev approximation in general or uniform approximation. So what we're actually doing here, we are trying to minimize maximal deviation. So we have a function which we want to approximate and we construct approximations. So we normally take approximations from some classes of functions. So for example, polynomials, right? And then what we do, we adjust the coefficients. So the coefficients of the polynomial are subject to optimization. So from optimization, what we know that such kind of problems, they normally as the optimality conditions, so they normally involve maximal deviation points. Okay, so and is it polynomial approximation or any other type of approximation? So if we see uniform, then probably there will be something to do with maximal deviation and with the so-called alternating points. So in the case of polynomials, it is really easy to, in theory, it is easy to verify necessary and sufficient optimality conditions. So what you need to do, you need to check the points of maximal deviation. So deviation of your function and the approximation. And if you have n plus two alternating points, so n is the degree of the polynomial, so you need two more, right? So you, for a polynomial of degree n, you have n plus one coefficients and you need one more. So two more than the degree. So, and if you have exactly n plus two or more, so at least n plus two, then your approximation is optimal. Okay, so we're talking about approximation of a univariate function on an interval. So for example, AB, like I have here, okay? So, but of course, from practical point of view, especially with the computers, so how would you decide if it's maximal deviation or not? So you basically have to go through all the points. So, but in any case, so the conditions are really very nice, very elegant. So But what will happen if we change our problem a little bit? So for example, if instead of univariate functions, we are trying to approximate multivariate functions. So what will happen in this case? We don't have alternating sequence because actually their points are not totally ordered, right? And on the top of that, just to make our life even harder, so in the case of just classical polynomial approximation, so we are looking at monomials, and monomials, they form the so-called Chebyshev system. And that actually means that if we need to, let's say, solve some linear systems, there will be a unique solution. So because certain determinants are non-zero. So what actually happens in multivariate approximation, even if we are still in the area of polynomial approximation, but multivariate, so the system is not Chebyshev system anymore. Okay, so, and that involves quite a few difficulties here. There are still some generalizations. So for example, instead of alternation of the deviation, so some researchers consider some alternation of certain determinants, and there are some geometrical objects which you can construct instead of alternating sequences, but it's really now becomes much harder to work with. Okay, so now, but I'm going to talk about rational approximation. So there are probably several motivations for that. Okay, so first of all, so if we're talking about polynomial approximation, then such kind of polynomials, right? So they are quite nice functions because they are continuous, they are smooth, it's easy to work with them. The problems under consideration, especially if we are, the problems under consideration are actually convex. So we really can handle them. So, but there is a problem. What if you need to approximate a function which is not, for example, smooth? So polynomials are not a very good choice. What to do if we need to approximate functions that are discontinuous? So that's actually even harder. So, and because of that, so there are quite a few generalizations of polynomial approximation. And let's maybe just talk about some of them. So first of all, if you have polynomials, probably the next step will be to construct polynomial splines or piecewise polynomials. So here, if you know where you have to switch from one polynomial to another, if you know these points, then once again, you have convex problems and it's really not very hard to find approximations, suitable approximations. If, however, the knots, the points of switching from one polynomial to another, if they are free, so they are also part of your decision variables, then it becomes really much harder. So rational approximation is really a very, very good, let's say, substitute, because the corresponding patterns which you can create using rational approximations, they are much more flexible. So by rational approximation, I mean ratios of two polynomials. So that's what it means, rational approximation. And sometimes the mathematicians, they probably would also talk about the so-called generalized rational approximations. So that's basically ratios of linear forms. But the functions in these linear forms where you optimize the coefficients, so they don't have to be restricted to monomials. Okay, so if, and we call such kind of functions basis functions. So if basis functions are monomials, then it's rational approximation. If they are from some other classes of functions, then that's generalized rational approximation. Okay, now let's have a look at this picture. So this picture was provided by Grigory Tamasyan. So it's not my picture. Unfortunately, I didn't really understand from which paper this picture was taken from. So maybe it's from actually one of the presentations. So, but what is important here? So here I have the approximation of the function sine x by a rational function where the degree of the numerator and denominator is 4. So it's not really a very, very high degree, but you can see how nicely I approximate I mean, it's not me, it's Grigory Tamasyan, so he approximates the sine function. So I should say that there is a very, very nice background here, because there are actually quite a few problems which are attributed to Zolotarev. So he was working on polynomial and rational approximation. And the fourth problem happened to be equivalent to exactly approximation of the sine function. So what we have here, we actually approximate the sine function, of course, not on the whole interval. So, but here we are approximating on the interval between minus 9 and 9, excluding the segment minus 1, 1. Okay, so of course, we still have to exclude 0. But on, say, the left and right branch of the approximation, so the approximation is really very, very accurate. And we have actually, in total, we have 10 alternating points. Okay, so here, although we need to be careful, because this is not approximation on a segment, because some of the pieces are removed, right? So from the middle. But nonetheless, it's really very, very nice illustration how powerful rational approximation is. All right, so now let me talk a little bit more about my personal motivation. So what actually brought me into rational approximation. So I was really interested in free node splines. But the, as I said, the problems are really very, very hard. And then there was a very nice paper by Petrushev and Popov. And they actually, let's say, they didn't say that I can substitute free node approximation by rational approximation. But they are talking about some kind of asymptotic behavior of these two. So, and the problem of approximation by free node splines is really very hard. And I think in a way, approximation community already gave up on it quite a bit. But nonetheless, it was listed as one of the most important problems for approximation. That was in the 90s, right, of the 20th century. But there was not much progress, really. So, and I've decided to try rational approximation, because the corresponding problems, okay, maybe they're not convex, but it looks like they're at least quasi-convex. Okay, so now for rational approximation, there are also necessary and sufficient optimality conditions. And of course, not a big surprise, they are formulated in terms of maximal duration points, so alternating points. So how many points do we need? So if we have the degree of the numerator is n and the degree of the denominator is k, then, so that's how many we need to have. We need to have n plus k plus 2 minus d. And now there is this d, which is the so-called defect. So what actually happens here? So just imagine you have a ratio of two polynomials. And imagine that they have common roots. So then basically this ratio is equivalent to another one. Okay, so you can remove some of the extra degrees, right? So, but of course, when you start approximating a function by a rational function of, say, certain degree for numerator and denominator, you wouldn't know in advance this D defect. And in many cases, it actually makes your life really very hard if you are trying to develop numerical methods. Okay, but the result itself is really very beautiful and was obtained by Achiezer in 1956. So really very beautiful result and obviously connected to Chebyshev result. All right, so now this is my second part of the talk. So we're going to talk about connection between approximation and optimization, illustrating exactly how rational approximation connected them. So for rational approximation, I would say that there was really a lot of research done probably in the 60s, 70s of the 20th century. And there were several numerical methods. So let me just mention some of them. So first of all, so it's probably not a method, but the whole group of methods, so called Remes-like methods. Okay, so Remes method is a very powerful method for polynomial approximation. And because of that, definitely there were quite a few attempts to extend this method to rational approximation. Let's say in some cases, this method works really very well, but so it should be, first of all, univariate approximation. And second, you need to have enough alternating points. So if you don't have enough, so that means your defect is not zero, then unfortunately this method may crash. Okay, and that's the main problem here. So you don't know in advance if it's going to crash or not. Okay, so but this is a very, very good method, and it works very well if certain conditions are satisfied. So the second method, so in the literature, it appears as linear inequality method. So I will demonstrate this method, how or what it is actually from the point of view of optimization. So then another one, so called differential correction. So I think this is probably one of the most popular methods for rational approximation. What is actually really good about differential correction method? So this method, first of all, it doesn't crash. Okay. Second, under some conditions, it has quadratic convergence, so which is also quite important. So, but if we are talking about, say, linear inequality method and differential correction, and many, many other methods which were developed in the 60s, 70s, so they are relying on linear programming. And it's not surprising because 60s, 70s, I probably would say this is the golden age of linear programming. And most methods, so if you can somehow reduce your problem to solving a certain linear programming problem, then it was really a very, very big advantage. So many other methods, but almost all of them rely on linear programming, which is quite good because we know how to solve linear programming problems. Okay, so now what happens from the point of view of optimization here? And I already mentioned that the corresponding problems are quasi-convex. Okay, so first of all, a ratio of linear forms is a quasi-linear, or to be more precise, quasi-affine function. Okay, as a function of the coefficients of these linear forms. And now if we look at our objective function where we are trying to minimize supremum of the absolute deviation. So what is absolute deviation? It's basically maximum between F minus approximation and approximation minus F, right? So maximum of quasi-convex functions is quasi-convex. So, and then we take supremum over the whole segment. So our functions are quasi-convex. So quasi-convex is not just a general non-convex problem. So we have some tools to work with these problems. Okay, so what I have on this slide is the actual formulation of the problem. So what I want to minimize maximal deviation. So at the moment I'm talking just about approximation on an interval, so just univariate functions. So, and I want the denominator of my rational function to be strictly positive, okay? So, or I can also require it to be strictly negative, okay? So I just don't want to pass through zero. So that's what I want. So of course, in numerical experiments, when I convert everything to linear programming, so I have to substitute this constraint for the denominator by a constraint where the quantity is, say, greater or equal to delta, where delta is a positive number. So that's how I should do it. So G and H, they are my my basis functions, okay? And what I really need to optimize is the coefficients with these basis functions, okay? All right, so now this is an equivalent problem reformulation. But this reformulation is quite important because this is basically a hint how I'm going to solve my problems. So what I want to do, I want to minimize Z. And what is Z? Z is actually my deviation. So I want my deviation to be less than Z. So since I don't know the sign of the deviation, I have to consider both F minus approximation and approximation minus F. And I have to keep my denominator away from zero. So that's also another constraint which I need to add. So, but the denominator constraint is really nice because it's a linear constraint, while for the other two groups, they are not. So why they are not? Because so Z is a variable and the coefficients of the denominator, they are also variables. So basically I have a product, so it's not linear constraint anymore. But what I can do, so I can actually try to fix Z, right? So suppose that I know Z. In this case, my constraints are linear. So I have linear constraints, although of course I'm minimizing a constant, which doesn't really make much of a sense. But what I can do, I can start bisecting my deviation, okay? So, what it is actually a quite a well-known bisection method for quasi-convex functions. So, but this method is also exactly the same what was called inequality, linear inequality constraints for rational approximation. So basically in the 60s, so they were using this method without knowing that this is actually a bisection method which can be applied to quasi-convex functions. To be honest, the theory of quasi-convex optimization was not very well developed yet at that time, but that's basically when we start having some interconnections. Okay, so here is the pseudocode for bisection. So basically what I do, I just get some estimations for my upper and lower bounds. So, and then I assign Z to be the point in the middle between upper and lower bound. So, and then I check if my system of inequality constraints has a feasible point, then I can actually say that this middle point between upper and lower bound, the point of bisection, so that's my new upper bound, right? Sorry, that's my new upper bound, yes. And if I don't have any feasible point, then that's the lower bound. Okay, so, and then my interval becomes smaller and smaller, and eventually I come really very close to my solution. So, and I know how far away from the optimal solution I am, okay? So this method is really quite robust. So I always have estimation how far away I am from the optimal solution. So the only thing is we need to know how to solve the feasibility problem, okay? So, and in this case, it's simple because I have a polytop, so I basically just solve a linear programming problem. So again, I reduce my problems to solving linear programming problems. I know how to do it, so I can proceed. Okay, so now, let me say a few words about generalized fractional programming, because this is something that really relates to my rational approximation problem. So fractional programming without generalization. So that's when one needs to minimize a ratio of two linear forms subject to linear constraints. And there was a method, Dinkelbach method, which was developed for this kind of problems, and it worked really very well. So, but in my case, so I'm not really minimizing the ratio of polynomials, but I'm actually minimizing so the maximal possible of such kind of functions, right? Because I have, so if I'm approximating a function which doesn't involve the coefficients, then that's pretty much another quasi-linear function, so that's all good. So, but if I need to take the maximum, so that's the generalized fractional programming. So I minimize not a rational function, but actually a function which can be obtained as supremum of fractional functions, and I can demonstrate that this is the case for rational approximation. So I probably just not always will have monomial basis, but it's still ratio of linear forms. So that's enough. And what actually happened? It happened that Dinkelbach method is the generalized Dinkelbach method developed for generalized fractional programming is the differential correction method. So once again, there is a clear correspondence between these two methods. So, but one was developed for approximation community and another one for optimization community. So we just need to translate from one language to another one. Okay, so now, how would I compare bisection and differential correction? So as I said, differential correction has quadratic convergence, but it's only when there are quite a few, you know, assumptions. So first of all, the proof was obtained for univariate functions. Second, that's for rational approximation. So my basis functions have to be monomials. And finally, the most difficult to check is full alternation. So that's something I wouldn't know in advance. So therefore, differential correction is definitely better than bisection if all these conditions are satisfied, but unfortunately, it's not always the case. And there is definitely a nice advantage of using bisection. I always know how far away I am from the optimal solution, while for differential correction, so basically I would stop when my improvement is not significant. And I don't know, maybe I'm actually still far away from the optimal solution, okay? All right, so now, if I'm talking about methods for rational approximation, I also need to mention one more group of methods, but I will just mention them, so-called near optimal approximation. So these methods are really very, very powerful, very fast, and they rely on the location of the roots of Chebyshev polynomials. Okay, so that's basically where it goes. So, but these methods are really, they are near optimal. So they are very, very practical, but since my goal is to study optimization side of the problem, so I'm not really using this method. Sometimes I compare their results with mine, but I don't really invest my time in this kind of method. So they are really good, very practical, but I don't really do any research in this area. So let me just show you maybe one picture. So this picture was provided by Vinesha Paris. She is working on rational approximation together with me. So basically what you can see here, you can see the approximation of the function absolute value t minus 0.25. So the function is non-smooth. So for some methods, it's really very difficult to approximate such kind of functions. So, and the red part is the bisection, while the black one is the so-called triple A. So that's exactly one of the near optimal methods. And you can say that, you can see that at the point 0.25, that's exactly where we have non-smoothness. So the black one is going a little bit further than the red one. Okay, so that's where we have some higher deviation, but you can see that the approximation is still really very, very good. It just, if for some reasons you really want to be very precise around the point of non-smoothness, then probably you might have to use something else, not triple A. But the method is very, very powerful, so I really should admit. So now let's talk about some applications here. So in the first application is in computational chemistry, and it's about heat integral. So what is interesting here, so I'm working with not univariate functions anymore, but with multivariate. Well, I'm just restricting myself to two dimensions. So these people need to do, they need to approximate the function g, which is basically the so-called incomplete gamma function, okay? So, and what they noticed before I actually was involved here, so they noticed that there is a kind of coefficient which involves an exponent and then function h. Okay, so what people in computational chemistry, what they do, they actually approximate h and then multiply by the coefficient, and that's how they get the approximation for g. Okay, so and if you look at it, you think, oh, maybe this is a very, very good illustration where you have to use non-monomial basis for rational approximation. So that's what I thought when I started working with this problem. And I definitely didn't feel very comfortable to approximate H when I can approximate G directly. So I just use the exponent as part of my of my basis, non-monomial basis. So let's have a look at the pictures. So this is the function g, which I have to approximate. And you can see that it's nice and flat. And then there is a small, well, it's small peak, but it's a very abrupt peak. Okay. So, and that's something which is really quite difficult to approximate. So now let's have a look at this picture. So this is h. This function is definitely simpler. So I understand people who would prefer to approximate this function. But what if my maximal deviation would magnitude by multiplying by this coefficient with the exponent? So maybe it will destroy all my work. So maybe it's not really a very good idea to do it this way. So that's what I asked my colleagues, and they said, well, we actually do it this way, and it's probably better this way. So let's have a look at the, let's have a look at the coefficient. So the coefficient actually, the coefficient actually looks like this. Okay, so I do have some problem with the peak, because if I multiply my maximal deviation by this abrupt change, you know, in to the left, so I'll probably destroy it. But then what actually happened when I tried to do it the way I wanted and the way which was traditional in computational chemistry, I actually realized that they were right. So, and then there was a presentation by Professor Morris. He was talking just 2 weeks ago, and he was talking about gamma function, not this one, incomplete gamma function. And so basically it looks like there is some kind of asymptotic behavior, which is multiplied. So basically you have some polynomial or maybe rational functions multiplied by exactly this coefficient. So maybe what it means that I won't get this, you know, magnified deviations. So probably computational chemistry people were right, although they are working with incomplete gamma function. And so in that presentation, it was about gamma function. So there is something I have to investigate before I would know for sure what exactly is going on. So, but it looks like indeed, it is more beneficial to approximate H, not G. So approximate h and then multiply by this coefficient with the exponent. Okay. What is also interesting, so we are now working with multivariate functions, and it looks like bisection method is actually much more stable than differential correction. Okay. So differential correction still works for multivariate settings, but it looks like maybe because it's more complex, maybe because really I stopped prematurely because I don't have much of the improvement. So bisection worked really better. But as I said, I only have the results for quadratic convergence for differential correction only in the case of univariate approximation. All right, so now the second application that actually relates to neural network and also deep learning. So, well, it's a very interesting research topic, and it's quite fashionable. So artificial intelligence, this is part of machine learning and artificial intelligence, but there is quite a bit of mathematics here, which we really should investigate if possible. So of course, most rigorous mathematical models are developed just for some simple types of neural network and deep learning, but there are some models. And let me also share my experience working with such kind of problems where I was trying to apply rational approximation. Okay, so what actually happens in neural network? So first of all, they say that they are trying to mimic human brain, how human brain is working. I'm not sure if medical doctors would agree because they know how brain is working. So, but what they have in neural network, so they have the input, so that's the black dots. So then they have some layers, so hidden layer, maybe more than one, and then the output layer. So basically you put some input, you get some output. Probably there is a function in between, but for the users, it's a black box, okay? So, and what we can do in optimization, so we can try to maybe open this black box, present it as an optimization problem, and probably solve it, and hopefully better than the black box, right? So that's the idea here. And of course, on the internet, you can see a lot of very nice animations where they explain how the different layers are connecting to each other, where all the optimization problems appear. So, and I cannot compete with this kind of presentations. They're just really very, very artistic. So, but I will give you some idea where there is some optimization hidden in neural network. Okay, so first of all, there is the whole framework here. And and there are some components. So first of all, the so-called activation function. So here it's sigma activation function. And activation functions, what is really important for them, so they should be non-constant, non-linear. So there are quite a few mathematical results for activation functions as sigmoidal functions. Okay, and this kind of functions I apply to some kind of affine transformation. And what we really need to do, we need to optimize the weights of this affine transformation, so W. So that's the decision variables. Okay, so if you, so this is the situation where I have no hidden layer, right? But what does it mean, no hidden layer? It just means that I go, say, from input layer to the first, let me just go back. So it just means that I go from input layer to the output. So, but I can also split my network into two parts. So I go from input to first hidden layer, then from first to the second, and then to the output. So basically you can somehow decompose your network into the model where you only have input and output and nothing else. So, but if you have more than one hidden layer, then you repeat this kind of transformation. So weights, activation several times. So it's a kind of composition of the functions. Okay, so, what you really have, you have a function which goes from input to output, but of course you don't know the formulation of this function. You are trying to approximate it. So that's all what you can do. Okay, so, and now, as I said, in most results, at least my results, so they are actually based on the models where we go from input to output directly without hidden layers. But as I said, if you have hidden layer, it's just some kind of composition. So you decompose and do it step by step. So of course, it's not always optimal solution, but that's how, let's say, how this black box works. Okay, now I would say that the first time rigorous mathematical background for neural network was developed in probably late 80s and in the 90s of the 20th century. So what they did, they proved the so-called universal approximation theorem. So really very, very nice title, universal approximation. But simply what they are doing, they are proving that the function, the approximation, so if you approximate, say, your input-output function in the form of affine transformation activation function, another affine transformation activation function. So if you have only one hidden layer, so again, there are mathematical models, rigorous mathematical models are only developed for the case when you don't have too many hidden layers. So then, so the approximation is dense, right? So that means if you can increase the number of nodes, so you can actually get very, very good approximations. And in a way, it really, it's really very similar to, say, approximation by polynomials if you can increase the degrees, right? So, but universal approximation, that sounds really very, very interesting. Okay, so now, just a little bit of a history and maybe some kind of background. So first of all, the idea comes to the famous Kolmogorov-Arnold representation theorem, which actually says that any continuous function can be presented as a composition of just summation and univariate functions. But of course, there was no way, no algorithm to construct this kind of functions. And because of that, so all what actually mathematicians could do is to try to approximate this function. And that's where this universal approximation theorem appeared. So I probably would say that, so the theorem which I formulated in the previous slide, so it's a kind of, you know, the overall what we can see from the works of Sibenka, Horneck, and also Pincus and other researchers. So I actually put the list underneath, so what it means Pincus at all. But what they actually do, they actually producing some work on what kind of activation function you should have to make sure that you will be close to the function you are trying to approximate, okay? Interestingly enough, the most common activation function, which is now used in deep learning, so they actually don't satisfy the conditions for activation functions from the papers by Sibenka, Horneck, or Pincus, okay? But it works, okay? All right, so now I have three applications, but I will not have time to talk about all three of them. So I'll probably talk just about the first and the last one. And the second one, if everything goes well, that's something I'm going to present at OCMS meeting. Okay, so that's why I will not spend much time on it, but I have the slides for it. So if you have questions and we have some time after my presentation, we can discuss it. So the first application, that's where we have, say, a kind of time series. And instead of trying to actually do all the classification with this time series, we approximate them first and then apply all this classification to approximations. So, and amazingly, it actually worked much better. Okay, so just to, you know, just a little bit of a spoiler here. So the second application, as I said, I will not talk about it here, so at OCMS meeting, but that's basically one of the applications where we demonstrate that so some activation functions, commonly used activation functions, they actually give rise to quasi-convex approximation, and we know how to handle them. Okay, and finally, the last application, which is really very, very new, it's not published anywhere. So that's where we're going a little bit against the, let's say, the general framework for deep learning, because instead of using the alternation between affine transformation and activation functions, we're actually approximating everything just by rational function because it's so powerful, okay? All right, so first of all, a general idea for the first application. So, and this paper is published, okay, so it's already published. So all what we do, as I said, we just approximate our time series, and then we apply classification not to the original time series, but to approximation. So would it work or wouldn't it work? So here is the table where I can show you the results. Okay, so the first big column, that's the approximation accuracy, which we could reach if we just work with raw data without any approximation. So you can see some of the accuracy levels are higher, some are lower. So at the very end of the table, you can see the results for a certain number of, let's say, nodes in the hidden layer. So that's basically what is recommended, but there is no mathematical theory behind it. So how many you need to choose. But as you can see, our accuracy is actually higher. So somehow it's actually really beneficial. Maybe we are removing some noise when we do all this approximation. So, but our approximation accuracy is actually higher. So we have two models here. One is just rational approximation, and another model, that's where we also use some kind of frequency, which comes from, so this is classification of brain waves. So some kind of frequency, which actually comes from the nature of the wave. So we can discuss it a little bit later, but basically we have two models, and it looks like, so we don't even have to go for the most sophisticated one with six features. So five is enough. So five numbers give us better accuracy than 4,097. So that's actually really quite interesting. So here we have one hidden layer, and we also have similar results for two hidden layers. So again, our models, model one and model two, so they actually produce really quite good classification accuracy. So somehow our approximations are not only good approximations, but they removed the noise, which actually was destroying approximations. All right, so now the second application, which is already about, as I said, going a little bit against the framework of deep learning, but from optimization point of view, there is absolutely nothing wrong here. So instead of constructing the approximations for the input-output function, which exists because of Kolmogorov-Arnold theorem. So we actually construct this approximation as a rational function. So that's what we are doing, okay? So what you can see on this slide is exactly this decomposition, right? So instead of multivariate function, you can have some kind of compositions, so summation of univariate functions, but we don't know how to construct them. So instead, we are approximating this function by rational functions. Okay, so now I have a lot of results, but let me just walk through them together with you. So first of all, I have several data sets. So I put them into two groups. So what is underneath is probably not so interesting, because there is definitely something where my approximation was very, very confused. So, but let's have a look at the top group. So when I'm talking about the size, so the first number tells me how many features I have. So how long my vector is. Right, so each point is a vector in the data set. So the second number tells me how many vectors I have in the training set. That's where I develop my model. That's where I actually do the approximation. And the third number tells me how many numbers I have in the test set. So what actually happens after I do the approximation on my training set, then I just apply my approximation to the test set. So basically I don't want to mix the accuracy with what I was using to develop my model, right? So that's what I'm doing. So, and now let's have a look at the training set accuracy. So you can see that almost everywhere I have 100% in the first group. So this is actually not so surprising, because let's say I have, quite a few, so my vectors are of high dimension. So, and if I have rational approximation, so I basically just simply have, I don't have enough points, right? So I get overfitting here. So, but in the examples where I have more say higher dimension than the number of points. So for example, electric device. So you can see that the train set is so 100% accuracy and the test set is actually almost 86. So unfortunately, I don't know the best accuracy here, so it was not reported on this website. But so first of all, I really have a very, very nice accuracy for say the points which I can access. Okay, 100% means I have perfectly, I'm perfectly matching my function at the points where I know input and output. So in the second group, the approximation was not so good. So as I said, probably somehow my approach is not so suitable here. So somehow my approximations were really very, very confused and didn't really do approximation very well. So coming back to the first group of the results. So maybe what I can do in the data sets where I have very few points, but the dimension of the input set is high, maybe what I can do is to apply my first application, right? Where instead of plugging the whole big vector, so the time series, so I actually approximate it and only use very, very few features. So maybe that's what I actually can do here. So maybe that would work. But in any case, it looks like the approximation is really quite rational approximation that is really powerful and it's not computationally expensive. Okay, so and finally, this is my last slide. So what I'm going to do next. So my very, very ambitious goal is actually to apply abstract convexity here. Abstract convexity is some kind of generalization of convexity where so we have so not only affine functions can be used as basis functions, but some other types of functions. And I think for Chebyshev approximation, it really makes sense to apply these kind of techniques because we also have supremum. Right, so they naturally come here, but of course there are still quite a few open problems here. So I don't have, say, uniqueness, and that's really quite annoying when I'm trying to construct numerical methods. But what is actually important about quasi-affine functions? So if I'm working not with affine functions like in classical convexity, but with quasi-affine functions, so the level sets are half spaces. So if I have intersection of half spaces, I still have polytops. So maybe this is something where I can actually progress more than just general abstract convexity theory does. So hopefully that's where I can get some more results. But this is my future research directions and open problems. So I'm not sure if it will work, but if it will, I'll let you know. So I think this is all. So thank you very much. So now time for questions, if there are any.
Thank you, Nadia, for your nice talks. Yes, now it's time for discussions. Anyone, if anyone have a question or comment, please unmute yourself and ask Nadia, please.
Excuse me, may I ask a question?
Yes,
this
please.
Is Evgeny Norminsky from Vladivostok.
Hello.
Hello, Nadia. Getting back to your chemical example, I'm just a little bit wondering why you are using, in approximation, you are using why are you using this M plus two in approximation? Because at zero, you can ignore exponent and the integral of x to the power M plus two will behave like x to the power M plus one. Well, divided, of course, in the denominator.
Yeah.
It may work better, probably. Did you try it?
Okay, so what actually happened here? So first of all, x doesn't the function was actually offered to us by chemistry people, and they didn't really use x equals zero. From my memory, it was starting from x equals five, so they didn't actually come very close to zero. So it was really, let's say, they asked us to approximate this function, and that's what we did using bisection. But I understand, so what you mean is really why not taking this monomial inside H, right? So that's probably what you are saying. So and that was
you can interpret this.
So you have a rational function, so why this one is so special? So, and I should say that was my first idea. So why don't we put it all inside, and we can even take the exponent inside, because I knew how to approximate by the function with non-monomial basis, but it didn't work all that well. So I just simply was doing this way and that way, and eventually, so it was better, you know, this way. So I approximate H and then multiply. Mm-hmm. So, but it probably it's because really there is this asymptotic behavior, which, let's say, again, Professor Morris is here. So he's, so when he was showing the slide, it was for gamma function. This is incomplete gamma function. So again, I'm not copy pasting, but basically there was a coefficient with exponent, and then there was a rational function or maybe polynomial. So it looks like it really will not happen that my multiplier will magnify the absolute deviation. So, but I have to, the presentation was just 2 weeks ago, so I need to get into it. So mm-hmm. yeah, it looks like this asymptotic behavior, it does work in such a way that it is more beneficial to take x to the power e to the power minus x divided by x to the power m plus 2 as a multiplier, and then approximate h. So, but again, mm-hmm. I didn't have time to investigate all the issues here, but it's probably this asymptotical behavior for approximating mm-hmm. gamma functions.
Yeah, thank you. May I just ask right away another question? In one of your last slides, there was this Kolmogorov-Arnold approximation. Yes, maybe
this one.
Oh yeah, stop. This is just two levels of this composition. Are there any estimate in the Kolmogorov theorem of how many layers of this additions and univariate function applied to the sum of the functions, etc. Can you recall, are there any estimations for the number of layers in the theorem?
I only know that, first of all, I believe for general function, of course, it's just impossible. Only the dimension, only this formulation, very, very general. But apparently, exactly for neural network, there are some estimations. So how many, layers you need. So for neural network, because this is a very special function. I can give you actually even the references. And they actually came really with very, very nice titles. So one title was Kolmogorov-Arnold theorem is irrelevant for neural network.
Neural network.
But of course they didn't question the mathematical side. It's just because they want everything to run fast and smooth, and this kind of representation that exists, but it may be really not in a very, very simple form. So they just would prefer to ignore it. But then there were quite a few papers after that with the title, so this representation theorem is relevant, and that's exactly where they were they will investigate and say this representation in application to neural network. So there are some results here, and I can give you the references. So I just need to put the notes so that I will send you an email.
Thank you. But in your work, did you try something like 3 levels or 5 levels of this?
No. I use no hidden layer. So I go directly from input to the output. But you see what I'm actually trying to do here, I'm exactly trying to avoid the framework in deep learning. I'm just trying to bypass it. And of course, if ever I publish this paper, I will have a lot of criticism from neural network people because I'm going against their procedure.
Mainstream.
That's right, yes. But from optimization point of view, it's perfectly fine because this is a function which I'm going to approximate, and why not approximate it by a rational function, right? So from optimization point of view, there is nothing wrong, but deep learning people probably will criticize me a lot, but I'm prepared.
Thank you. Thank you. And looking forward for your references.
Yeah, we'll send it to you. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
Do you know my address?
I will find. But if you send the message to me, But we'll find.
Okay.
We still have time for one or two quick questions, please. Maybe I have a quick question. So for your application in deep learning, for the network with layer with hidden layer, do you still have some generalized convexity?
I don't have. I'm afraid I don't, unless I look for some, depends what you take as, their elementary functions. So they are not quasi-linear functions, that's for sure, if you have at least one hidden layer. So that's really, unfortunately, rigorous mathematical models. You cannot go further than just one hidden layer, but for abstract convexity, I think even one hidden layer is too much.
Yes. But you still have some numerical simulation, right?
That's so right.
Okay.
Yeah, and actually one of the motivations for abstract convexity, so if there is some results in duality, so that I really know how far away I'm from, the optimal solution, similar to bisection, compared to differential correction. So I really would prefer to have these estimations, and then I need duality, and for duality I need abstract convexity. So hopefully that will work together, but I don't know. I know that abstract convexity is a very, very difficult area, very hard to find nice illustrations and examples, but again, would like to try.
Okay, yes, that interesting problems.
Yeah.
Thank you, Maria. Any questions?
Could I just make one quick comment?
Yes.
When I published my article on Kolmogorov-Arnold theorem in 2013 in Bulletin of the American Math Society, a number of people did write to me who indicated, more or less, that I didn't quote their work. And some of it was indeed related to its relationship to neural networks. So it is really quite an active area.
Yeah, you see, when Professor Morris is coming, so he's given a talk about Kolmogorov theorem, then about, approximation of the gamma function, then I just, pick the fruits and put in my research. Yeah, thank you so much, Sid.
My pleasure.
Thank you all. And if we have no questions, so join me to thank Nadia again for the nice talk today. And thank you all for joining us today, and hope to see you next week.
Yeah, Thank you all. Thank you so much for coming. It's late, but you are here. Thank you.